And welcome. We are few in number today, but we will harness the Wednesday energy and persevere. So I have a couple birds eating tasty food for you today. The first is a great blue heron that's found itself a big fish, and you might say that's an awful small bird head compared to the size of the fish, but the heron, no problem, just swallows the whole thing down, scales, bones, eyes, everything. You know, it's just gonna digest for a while. But fish, still soft, flexible, compared to, say, this female hooded merganser attempting to make a meal out of a crawfish. Crawfish, of course, a crustacean. It really does not want to be eaten, making every attempt to escape, but in the end, merganser wins, swallows down shell, pinchers, everything. So quite the strong stomach on this bird. All right. What questions do you have about the lab, while loops, anything we've been doing? All right. That must mean it is time for some practice. Seen that one? But we have not seen this one here. This is a function you may remember from a previous quiz, finding the minimum in a number in a list. And what I'm asking you to do is to figure out how many separate lines are going to be printed. So not what will be printed, but basically how many times is print going to be called when we run this code here, and if we total up how many separate lines are going to be printed. All right, some votes for each one, so please discuss with your neighbors how you're thinking about when these different print statements are going to happen. All right, we've had some movement towards 7, which is in the right direction here. So there are different ways we might think about this. Can someone share how you were approaching thinking about what is getting printed? Tammy?
So it's going to run through the whole list. Essentially, the way I thought of it is the first one is going to be the index number 6. So that's going to already, it's going to go through the loop since 6 isn't less than 6. It's just going to have that first print statement where the minimum is 6. Then you get to number 2. It's going to give you another 2 print statements where the minimum is not updated to 2. Then you're going to get to 9 where it's only going to give you that one print statement where the minimum number is still 2. And then you're going to go to the print statement number 1, which is going to give you another 2 print statements saying the minimum number is now 1. And then you have that final print statement, which is going to give you the final, which should be a total of 7.
Exactly. So one way is to, as Sammy did, we're going to just think through, we're going to be the computer and think through kind of what is going to happen at each step, and track through and see that we get all get these 7 print statements. Anyone take a different approach to thinking about how many lines would be printed? The other way that occurred to me was, as opposed to going through kind of line by line and thinking about what the program is going to do each line, think about logically where are these print statements located. And if one of them, this updating, happens whenever we find a smaller number. This minimum number is, I see that it's inside this loop over all the numbers outside of the if, so it's going to print out once for each of our 4 numbers. And then I know that we start our minimum at 6, and so there are two times that it would change. So that's once for each thing in the list is 4, 2 updates, and then I have to remember that it's printing out what findMin returns for a 7. Any questions on this? All right, one more function mystery for you. A count zeros function, have a couple prints. Again, how many lines are going to be printed? 4, 2, none of the above. We're all pretty confident it's not going to print out one. So please discuss with your neighbors again how you're thinking about what this will do. All right, big change here, and in this case, in the right direction. Who can tell us why this is only going to print out 2 lines? Gary.
So it'll go through the loop and print zeros found once it gets to that first zero conditional, but then there's a return in that conditional too, which stops our loop. So it'll print zeros found, and it'll print like how many zeros there are in the value, but then it will stop after that. So it'll only say that there's one zero.
Exactly. This function has an indentation problem where we want the loop to go through all the numbers in the list, but we know return, once we get to return, it ends the function. So we want return to be unindented to be outside our for loop. So we'll go through all the numbers in the list, check all of them, whether they're zero, and then only after the loop do we want to return zeros. Any questions on this one? Marcus.
If the indentation was correct, would there still be an issue because of zeros plus equals one?
So what issue are you thinking there might be with this line?
I thought it would be like that means zeros equals zeros plus one, right?
Mm-hmm.
So then wouldn't zeros then be equal to one, and then wouldn't that not count the other zero in the list for vowels?
So that's true of this current version. If we unindented the return, when we got to this first zero, we'd add one to zero, so now it would be one. And then when we got to the second zero, we'd again do zeros equals zero plus one, so now it's one plus one, and zeros would be two. Does that make sense?
Oh, I see what I did. Yeah.
Yeah, the plus equals one, we're going to kind of keep up adding up, totaling up the number of zeros. Every time we find a zero, we add one to a sort of count of how many zeros we've seen. Other questions? So speaking of indentation, something that's come up a fair amount on the lab that I thought I would mention is bugs due to how this analysis algorithm is indented. So just want to clarify that the indentation of this pseudocode is the indentation the actual code should have. They should match. So to sketch this out a bit, we have something like for state and states, and then somewhere inside there's this initialization step, and then inside this loop over states, we have a loop over elections, over all the like Alabama 1, Alabama 2, so on. Inside of that is this generate list of vote party tuple step. And the bullet point here says You would do this by looping over all the data lines. So, and we have some stuff inside this loop, and the one of the bugs that I have seen a lot is then this for each vote party tuple will show up inside this loop over data lines. But if we look at the pseudocode, it says this loop should be at the same indentation as this thing that's generating the list. This loop here is not inside this step, which means that this loop through all the tuples would be after, would be outside this loop over the data line. So if you're trying to debug your results and the numbers aren't quite matching up what's in the sample report, this would be something to check, that the indentation of your analysis matches how this pseudocode is structured. Any questions on that? All right, speaking of debugging, that's what I want to primarily focus on today. I think by now you have probably encountered that the time it takes to write the code the first time and then the time it takes to get that code to actually produce the desired result, it's often much faster to write it the first time than to go through the process of actually making it correct. And that process of taking code and fixing all the mistakes, making it correct, it's called debugging because the mistakes are bugs and we want to remove them. We want to debug our code. So I wanted to start by asking you to take a couple minutes and discuss with your neighbors strategies or things that you have tried when debugging the labs in this class so far, what might have worked well or that hasn't worked well, and then we'll collect your ideas. All right. Someone share an idea. Yeah, Eric.
Use a lot of print statements to check what's happening along the way.
Yeah. Print everything. The more you print out, the more information you have about what is going on inside your program. The one caveat to that is if you print, when I say everything, I mean like all the variables. What makes this challenging is if those variables are inside a loop, and say that loop goes around 51 times, and then an inner loop goes around 436 times, and then an inner loop goes around many more times than that. Then you just have so much printing out that it can be hard to focus on one piece of that. Has anyone found a way to balance or account for that? Yeah, Jonathan.
One of the things that my partner and I have found was useful is like if you want to check like how a list is updating, but you don't want to print out like every loop, just a giant list of data, you can use like len on the len function to just print out like the length of the list to see if that like changes through each iteration.
Then you can still kind of track like how it changes, but not have to look at a giant block of text that's kind of hard to navigate. Yeah, that's a good tip. Can we print out something that's like easier to tell what's going on than the full value? Yeah, Maya.
Just print out like one line of the data, so use indexing to control the amount of time it will be through.
Yeah, maybe we only print out one part or one element of something, so we control the volume that way. Issa?
Printing like outside of loops to make sure if you initialize any variables, if they're still maintaining that information.
Yeah, Yeah, if we print before and after a loop, that's a good way to check by the time we get to the end, is it what we expect? Were things what we expected before we even started the loop? Yeah, exactly. Yuto?
It might not be like the beginning, but when we first
Yeah, this is a really helpful thing to do. To give a specific example from the gerrymandering lab, if we're debugging, we have 50 states plus District of Columbia. That's a lot of stuff. But if I change my loop, instead of for state in states, while I'm debugging, say for state in brackets, just a list that contains Alaska, now my loop over states will just do Alaska, so I'll only see printouts from things that match Alaska. That's a much smaller amount of printing that I can easily kind of look through, and I picked Alaska because it has one congressional district, so there's just three lines in the data file that matches. I can go look at the data file and know exactly what all the numbers should be by hand. And so anytime I want to debug a loop that seems to be wrong for everything and in maybe the same way for each thing, to help me fix it, I might change my code temporarily to just focus on one. And that way, even though I'm printing everything inside these loops, I'm now only doing Alaska and I have much less printed output to sort through. Other thoughts on printing stuff as a debugging idea? So one other thing I'd add to this print is think about what you expect to be printed. So sometimes you're just wondering, is the code going to get to this line? Or how many things are sometimes it's just, does the code get to this line? Then we're just, does it print something or not? But other times it's, we're printing out the length of something, or we're printing out the vote total, or we're printing out our list of tuples, or whatever it is. And then there are kind of two parts to make this actually useful for debugging. We need to print it out, but then when we look at what's printed out, it doesn't come with like a red X or a green check mark to tell us whether what's printed out is right or not. That's up to us. We have to look at what's printed out and decide, is this correct? And the deciding if what prints out is correct or not is, when you write a print statement somewhere, you want to print out relevant variables, but you also want to think about what do you expect those to be so that you know whether it's correct or not. Because it's easy, if you don't think about this ahead of time, to print something out and sort of convince yourself, oh, that seems right. So the step of thinking about what you expect is an important one. Any non-printing or other kinds of debugging ideas that have come up or that you have used? Gabby?
I think, like, going off of that last point of, like, thinking about the expectation, is that if, like, everything is printing, the expectation thing is wrong. This is maybe an obvious thing, but using Python Tutor to, like, see exactly what's happening, because you know it'll, at that point, you know if it's running, so you can kind of identify it where it's going off track.
Yeah, that's a great suggestion, that we have different tools available to us. Python Tutor is a great one that can help us better understand what's going on in our program. So making use of that can be a great way to, if what the program is doing doesn't seem to be making sense, helpful to kind of get a second opinion, as it were. Other ideas? So I may be biased, but I would add to this list rereading the lab write-up, especially the testing advice section. The lab write-ups are designed to help guide you through doing the lab. The testing advice section will always give some guidance for how to check whether things are correct or not. So you don't need to necessarily go it alone to as you're debugging. And I've related to this, think about expectation, would be to focus on a specific example, and that's partly what I did here with changing my loop to just do Alaska. But in general, if there's some operation in our code, and we can focus on, okay, for a specific input or for a specific part of the data or some specific example, that we can work out by hand exactly what the output should be or exactly what it should do, focusing on just getting it working for that, rather than trying to think about kind of all possible things or inputs the program might have to handle, can be helpful as well. Any final thoughts, questions on general debugging stuff? All right. So Lab 4 is out today and is due Friday, and it's an individual lab, and it's a lab that's all about debugging. So the main idea of the lab is to, let me fix the font here. Is to fix this program that plays the game Hangman. And there's a hangman.py that I realize I did not have the projector on. There's a hangman.py that you will start with, and there are kind of six distinct bugs in this code. And part of the reason why this lab is due Friday, so that you don't have a lab over midterm break, but it's only 2 days, so we're going to start working on this lab here in class. So I have the lab write-ups here. I'm going to put, so we're all on the same page. If you're not familiar with the game Hangman, it's a word-guessing game, and you guess letters, and there are a certain number of guesses you have. So thinking of a five-letter word, someone give me a letter.
A.
There is no A.
E.
There is no E.
I.
I heard I.
S.
I heard S.
P.
There is no P.
D.
There is a D.
Recur.
It's birds. It's always birds. Okay, so that's the game of Hangman. The hanging man appears slowly over time. If that finishes, you have used up all your guesses and you have lost. Otherwise, you kind of keep track of which letters you guessed, and when you guess a letter, it fills it in. So this hangman.py, it has a bunch of strings set up already to display the hangman part. And so as the handout, the first page of the handout describes the hangman game, and then after that is sort of the bug detective section, where you're going to be trying to figure out and fix the bugs in this code. And the first thing we want to fix is this function that gets the player's guess. So let me run this code to show you what happens currently. It says, guess a letter. I say, well, A. And it says, that's not a letter. Well, now I'm pretty sure A is a letter. Okay, the second time, it just let me guess A. All right, how about 7? Well, let me guess 7. So there's some collection of issues with how this getGuess function is written that it's like just not behaving reasonably. So using the handout and either downloading the code yourself or using the code up here, work with your and work on your own or with your neighbors to figure out what the problems with this getGuess function are, and Dominic and I will be wandering around. So this is alpha, guess is alpha. That's a string method that returns true if all the things in the string are letters. Like we've seen is decimal, which is true when all the things in the string are numbers. Yeah, so I have some hints for the bugs in getGuess up on the board. In a couple minutes, we'll start looking at the next section, the play section. So it's fine if you haven't equipped the two getGuess buttons before then. I just want to make sure that we have a chance to work through the bugs in the first two sections of the lab. All right. So I just want to show you what we would expect the program to do once we fixed getGuess. When I run the program, ask for a letter, I can say A, that works. I can say 7 and 7 and 7 and 7, or AA, 3 S's, and it just keeps asking for a guess until I enter something. So that's working great. So now this play function has kind of all the other parts of the game are in this play function. We open the file full of words. We read the lines in that file. We make a random choice. And I have added this print word just so that while I'm debugging this, it will show me what random word it picks so I can know whether I'm entering a guess that's correct or incorrect. So when I run this, let's make this like this. All right, well, the word is detonator because I have 10 guesses left. So if I guess D, puts D in front, and it shouldn't subtract a guess for a correct guess, often how Hangman works. So the next letter in detonator is E. Well, that's a problem. It got rid of my first correct guess. It's back to being an empty spot. D, E, D, E, D, E. So it's not keeping track of the correct guess. What if I guess incorrectly? Nothing's ever showing up in this letters I've already guessed. If I guess a letter that I've already guessed, it should be saying you've already guessed that letter, enter a new guess. But something is wrong with think that there's a list somewhere of letters that I've already guessed, but I'm not adding things to that list how I need to be. So we want it to not erase previous correct guesses, and we want it to keep track of the letters that we've already guessed are kind of the next two bugs that we're dealing with in this play function. And I would focus your attention on the code inside the while loop here, which is kind of the actual playing of the game, and checking whether we got it right and keeping track of things. The code before the while loop is sort of setting things up, and that appears to be okay, at least for the two bugs that we're dealing with now. I have put a few hints about the play function up on the board. Guessed is a variable that has our list of already guessed letters. Probably want to be adding letters to it, maybe with the append method, in order for letters to actually show up. Second, when a guessed letter is wrong, we have this loop here that says guess equals equals word bracket I. And so when a guessed letter is wrong, when it doesn't match any letters in the word, you might think about, do we want to change the current like progress at all? And something to consider is that some bugs in this lab might be fixed by just removing code. They're not all fixed necessarily by changing code. You might just need to remove code that's incorrect. All right, we are at 20. So that will do it for today. Hopefully this gives you a good start on the lab. I have office hours in 8 minutes, and otherwise I will see you on Friday.